We're going to do this in English. These are the orders. Okay, sorry about the mess, but first time, you know, as I was saying, since January 1st, I think this is my 77th or 78th talk, which is a lot. And it's the first time that I plug my laptop somewhere and it reboots twice. So it's really a sign I should go on holiday, right? Thank you for not being in front of the TV and spending some time to listen to Jonathan and myself. Thank you so much for the invitation. I'm very happy to be present at the first meetup for you guys, so I wish you a lot of success. So my name is Julian. I'm a technical evangelist with AWS, and I think I've been here before. That's a private joke. You don't have to understand it. My presentation tonight. So if some of you guys were at the Container Day yesterday, so you were.
Yes.
You were, right? You were too. I remember you. Anyone else? Right? So don't worry. This isn't exactly the same talk. Actually, I did get some work done today. Right? And I figured some of you guys would be at both events, and I hate repeating myself as well. So the beginning of the presentation is similar, but then I have some demos that I actually didn't get any time to do yesterday. So there will be some new stuff, right? So don't fall asleep. Okay. So tonight, I want to talk about, I don't want to talk about Docker specifically. I don't want to talk about containers specifically, because I think we wouldn't be here if we didn't believe that containers are slightly interesting and help us build platforms better. I want to show you how, what are the options to run Docker clusters on AWS. And the key word here is clusters. I'm not interested at all in running one container. I'm interested in what happens when I'm trying to run thousands of containers on hundreds of nodes, right? That's the kind of problem that we're trying to solve here. So actually, before we dive into the actual presentation, it's always good to try and understand exactly why this is a hard problem, right? Because technology is always fun, but why is this a difficult problem? And what are we trying to do here? We're trying to do this. Remember when you were 3 years old, or maybe, you know, if you have kids, you have this somewhere in your living room if they're 3 years old. And what you're trying to do here is based on a grid of providing some resources, some spaces, right? You're trying to find the best place to put the yellow circle or the green triangle or whatever, right? And when you're trying to orchestrate containers, it's exactly the same problem. You have a grid of hardware resources, so mostly CPU and memory, right? Those are the two that would be the most important ones, but as we will see later on, network ports are actually quite important too. Anyway, you have a grid of hardware resources, and as fast as possible, as in the most scalable fashion, you want to find the right place to put the right container. And obviously, this is a simple problem when you have a 3x3 grid, right? So if you have one host and 9 containers, that's not a big problem, right? If you have 3 hosts and 3 containers, it's not a big problem either. Because there will be always more resources than there are containers, so you can just drop them pretty much anywhere you want. But again, think about larger platforms, and I will show you some examples, where people are running thousands of containers in a very dynamic fashion all day long, possibly millions of containers, and they want they always want to find the right spot to put it, right? And imagine if this grid was 1,000 by 1,000 instead of 3x3, right? Even trying to put some toys like this would be a difficult problem, right? In the beginning, it would be easy, but as you populate the grid, it gets more difficult, and it's quite likely that it would take you more and more time to find the right spot, right? And what I'm getting at here is actually the problem is finding space for your container and doing this in linear time, right? Ode 1 for the algo guys in the room. And this is something that ECS is pretty good at. So just, you know, if you're not super familiar with our Docker technologies, these are the ones I'm talking about. So ECS is our container orchestrator. It was launched over a year ago. It's available in both European regions and many other regions, but we're still Europeans, I suppose, right? We have a London region coming up next year, so will they call it EU-something or UK-something? You know, we'll see. Interesting. Just making fun of them, right? And now we have to face Iceland. Come on. Come on. But it's good. It's going to be a good game. Anyway, let's focus. The good thing about ECS is that actually it doesn't cost anything. So using ECS will not cost any money. What will cost money is the servers, the instances that you're going to start, right? But the service itself is as free as it gets when it comes to AWS. Later last year, we launched another service called ECR, which is a registry. It's a managed service for a Docker registry hosted in AWS. It's available in Ireland. It's not available yet in the other European region, but you know, it will be, obviously, in the future. So why would you want to use ECR instead of the Docker Hub? Well, if you have infrastructure in AWS, I guess it makes sense to have your Docker images closer to your instances, right? It reduces the loading times and it reduces the likeliness of something breaking down between your infrastructure and your images, right? And we all love the Docker Hub, but you know, sometimes it's not in a good mood. So ECR is highly available. It shouldn't break down. The cost is mostly based on storage, 10 cents per gig per month, plus a little bit for outgoing traffic. But it's a fairly competitive option. Remember, S3 is 3 cents per gigabyte per month. So for three times the price of S3, you get a managed Docker Hub. I guess that's a decent deal. And yesterday morning, as I was preparing for Container Day and routinely checking my emails, not expecting anything to happen, because, you know, it's summertime, I saw that EFS is finally available. And it's only been, you know, we've only been waiting for about a year and a half, so, you know. So EFS, in a nutshell, is a managed NFS service, which is something that literally thousands of people were sending me email about, and probably the most expected service at AWS in a long time. So basically, what you're doing here, it's fully managed. So you're just creating volumes, one click or one API call, creating an NFS volume in a region, and you just go to your EC2 instances and you mount them, right, using the standard NFS tools. And obviously you can share storage across EC2 instances. The really cool thing is, unlike NFS filers from last century, you don't have to provision anything. You just write to your volume and it will scale up and down as you add and delete files. So to me, that's, you know, that's the best news in a long time. It's something that has been painful in my previous life for 10 years. And it's kind of solved because it's, you know, you can just go and have /EFS and it's unlimited. So that's pretty cool. And it costs a third of a dollar per gigabyte per month. That's just the starting price. It's available in EU West 1 and in the US, in two US regions as well. So if you guys had that kind of issue, you know, it's kind of solved. I don't think it's really good news for the hardware vendors, but oh well. On top of that, we have a lot of partners. Some of them I will illustrate tonight. So I'm not going to read through the whole list, but obviously, you know, Docker and Mesosphere. Wiv, I will show you. You can run your favorite Docker Linux distribution. I don't know. I'm not sure if that's the official way of saying that, so I apologize if it's not. Okay, cool. Sorry?
Alpine.
Yeah, Alpine is, yeah, sure. It's not a partner, but you can run Alpine. You can run anything. Okay. So you can run a Core OS. I will show you how to run a Rancher, Rancher OS in ECS. Convox is a very cool product. It's former Heroku engineers who have built a new PaaS platform on top of AWS using Docker only. So if you guys like PaaS, if you like Heroku but wanted kind of the Docker version, the next step, you should look at Convox. You know, it's really, really great. We have a lot of CI/CD partners where you can integrate your Docker deployments and QA directly with ECS. Datadog for monitoring. And Twistlock, which is a company that scans containers for vulnerabilities, right? Because, you know, I won't talk at all about Docker security. But Jonathan mentioned it's a concern. I fully agree, it's a major concern. You know, you have Docker security bugs, but the biggest concern to me is, you know, moving container from the development PC to production without knowing exactly what's inside. So, you know, if I was the ops boss, you know, I would want to know what's inside those containers before I put them on the servers. So Twistlock and a few other companies will do that. So let's look at a few case studies before we dive into the tech, because, you know, at AWS, we are, of course, we're all about technology, but we like to talk about what our customers do. And I think it's the best way to illustrate what the technology can do is to let the customers speak about it. So the first one is Coursera. I don't think I have to introduce them. It's possibly the largest MOOC platform out there. And as you can imagine, they need to run a lot of batch jobs. So typical stuff like reporting, accounting, etc. But one specific use case I think is interesting is how they grade programming assignments, right? You have a lot of language courses on Coursera, and you can type code and execute it. And in the background, they will check it and run some unit tests against your code and give you a score, and, you know, that's how you pass or fail your assignment. And obviously this is highly untrusted code, right? Because it's really code coming from you and me, especially me. Highly buggy, highly untrusted. It could be a very, very large security risk for them. So they decided to use Docker to isolate the code uploaded by students, which is great. But given the scale that they're running at, you can imagine how, you know, they have to do that, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of time a day. So they have to automate those jobs and make sure they can always run them almost in real time, because when you're studying and you're coding, you want to know very quickly if you did a good job or not, right? You don't want to come back tomorrow to get your grades, right? That's what we did in high school. And, you know, when you're learning on a MOOC, you want to know immediately if you passed or failed. And so it's a complex problem, right? Going back to my initial slide, remember the 3x3 grid, these guys, you know, they have to face, you know, thousands and thousands of jobs that needs to be scheduled as quickly as possible to give back, to send some scores back to the student. And so they looked at some solutions. You can look at their video testimony here from reInvent last year, a very good video. You will know exactly who they tried and why, what they liked and what they didn't like. In the end, they picked ECS, mostly because it's a managed service. It makes their life easier, and it's highly customizable. And they wrote their own scheduler to make sure that the, you know, the programming, the grading jobs run, you know, get higher priority on the cluster than maybe some of the lower priority jobs. So it's something you can do here. So Coursera, next time you upload some code on Coursera, you know, you will be running a container on ECS. Another one is Remind. So Remind it's a messaging platform for students, teachers, and parents in the US. They're used by half the public schools in the US. They have over 30 million users and about 100 million or 200 million messages per month. So it's fairly large. And as you can imagine, these guys have a very bizarre traffic profile, because I suppose in the holiday, during the holiday, nothing happens. And then, you know, you have back to school, and then I suppose they have huge scalability issues. And then, you know, when the conseil de classe, you know, are happening, probably there's a lot of traffic too. And so it's, you know, it varies wildly and it's difficult. It was difficult for them. They have a microservice based platform and they were running on Heroku. And as you can see on the latency here for one of their service, you know, the average latency was kind of okay, but the 95th and 99th percentile are pretty bad, right? Not only are they really, really higher than average, but, you know, they can go crazy sometimes. And that means, you know, a few percent of your users are experiencing a really, really bad latency. And so they moved to ECS and they dockerized the platform and moved to ECS and migrated somewhere, you know, during the night of the 5th of June. And as you can see, you know, it doesn't need a lot of explanation. They divided the average latency by about, you know, by two, kind of. But more importantly, the marginal latencies are now extremely close to average and extremely flat, which means that, you know, almost 100% of their users get a great service. And why is that? It's because of the scheduling, of the speed, of the scheduling speed and scheduling predictability of ECS, where, you know, no matter what the load of the cluster is, no matter what the size of the cluster is, it can always find a spot, you know, in a matter of seconds to start a container and serve traffic, right? So, you know, when it comes to scaling, this is a good example. Another example is it's a company called Halo. It's a Uber. It's an Uber competitor in the UK, fairly large. They have a microservice-based architecture as well, and you know, in a similar fashion to Coursera, you know, they want to schedule some jobs faster than others. I guess, you know, when you're calling a taxi, you know, you don't want to wait for 10 minutes to get your job run, and you want those jobs to run at a higher priority that, you know, again, probably other stuff on the platform. And again, like Coursera, you know, they picked ECS. They wrote their scheduler, and they have a pretty cool technical presentation online with a lot of details. So I encourage you to read that to see how they did it and what were the benefits of that. And the last one I want to mention is it's a company called Segment, and they operate in the analytics sector. Again, microservice architecture, multiple ECS clusters, you know, which is a good way of doing things, I suppose. And they use other services with it that I'll show you later on, like ELBs and Route 53 for DNS, etc. And recently they published, they also built their own pass on top of AWS. It's based on Terraform for infrastructure as code. And in just a few lines of Terraform, they're able to deploy complex stacks on AWS, which are all based on Docker containers and ECS. So pretty cool example. Again, you know, it's an interesting approach. And it shows that, you know, customers, this maybe their initial requirement is to say, okay, we need containers, we need Docker. And then, you know, they try ECS. They enjoy the scalability, they enjoy the managed service side of ECS, and they learn about the way that they can extend ECS to make it, you know, exactly what they want it to be, like writing their own schedulers. And we see a lot of customers doing that. So let's look at architecture. So it's not really complicated. So let's look at the bottom part here, which is, I guess, where the real power of ECS lies. So there is a cluster management engine, which will schedule the jobs, make sure the right number of jobs is running, make sure the right number of containers is always running, et cetera, et cetera. So it's relying on a key value store, which is proprietary to Amazon, but it's based on Paxos. I guess Amazon knows a thing or two about key value, right? Having built DynamoDB. I'm not saying this is DynamoDB, I'm just saying probably something that looks like DynamoDB. I wouldn't be surprised. So all the distributed state in the cluster is stored here, right? And it's used by the management engine to make decisions. And we have a communication layer that interfaces with the actual instances. Each instance is running an ECS agent, which is itself a Docker container. And so the agent is responsible for reporting the state of the instance to the backend and obviously receiving orders from the backend to start containers, etc. So what is an ECS cluster actually? So an ECS cluster is that tiny dotted line here that you see. And within the cluster, we have multiple instances, which really are EC2 instances. All this stuff relies on EC2, right? So an ECS instance is really an EC2 instance with Docker installed and the ECS agent, okay? And all the good stuff that you may know from EC2 in the last 10 years, you know, auto-scaling groups and monitoring and security groups, all those notions are present here, right? I think it's good news because it means, and this is pretty rock solid. I mean, EC2, you know, it's been there for a while. It's been tested for a while. And the fact that ECS relies on that, to me, you know, it's a good sign that ECS is going to be fairly stable from day one and fairly efficient. So actually those instances, so we provide an Amazon machine image pre-installed with the Docker and ECS agent. If you look for it, it's called the ECS optimized AMI, right? But you're welcome to use anything else, right? I mean, the agent itself is open source. It's Go. It's Golang. You can grab the sources from GitHub. You can build it. You can install it on your own AMIs if you want to do that. You can also run CoreOS if you want. You can run Rancher if you want. And you can, as I will show you later, it's very easy to integrate Rancher OS with ECS and to use a Rancher server on top of that. Okay, and of course, so inside Docker, then I would say it's business as usual. You will run your containers. We have the task definition, which is, as I will show you, it's the equivalent of a Docker Compose file with a couple of additions for us. And based on the task definition, we're going to start those containers. If you need to put load balancers in front of your task and containers, that's fine, you can do that too. Okay, so bottom line, the magic is somewhere around here, right? The scalability and the distributed state management is managed here. All you need on your instance is to have the agent to report state and to apply orders coming from the backend. So, of course, I'm going to show you the console tonight, maybe a little bit of command line. But if you want to know what the command line for ECS is, that's it. I would say the important stuff is here. So we have a specific command line for ECS, which is called ECS CLI. Again, it's on GitHub. So this is just configuring the cluster, saying, well, I'm going to work with a cluster that's called my cluster running in Ireland. Up is going to create the cluster. I need a key pair to SSH on the instances. And I'm using three nodes. And I'm not giving any instance size, so by default it's going to be T2 micro, but you could use larger instances if you want to. And this will just destroy the cluster, right? So that's it. Three, you know, for a developer, I think it's a convenient way to start clusters, run some jobs and destroy them. You know, there's nothing complicated here. If you guys have used Elastic Beanstalk, another of our past services, you know, it's the same philosophy, a very simple command line. So that's just for starting the cluster, and then how do you actually start jobs in there? So you write, you can reuse your compose file from Docker. You just need to add a couple of variables, and you will call compose service up to start your service. So by default, it's going to start one copy of your container. You can use PS to list services. You could scale your services. If you want 8 copies of your service, that's all you would do. And you will let ECS find, you know, where to run those 8 copies. It's not, you know, you don't have to worry about that. And then you can stop service, you can delete it, right? And from a more infrastructure point of view, you can use the traditional AWS command line to list clusters, describe clusters, list your instances, etc. But I would say, you know, 90% of the time you will go up scale, and you know, and stop and down when you're done working, right? So for developers, it's pretty cool not to have to worry about any infrastructure stuff here. Okay, so let me show you quickly how we can deploy stuff on Rancher. Can you read in the back, or is it small? Oh, okay. Oops. Sorry. All right. So what I did here, actually, is I created a cluster called it Default, because that sounded like a good name at the time. Should have called it Rancher. And I've got three instances here, right? So to make that very clear, what are those instances? So they're virtual machines running Rancher OS, right? So I just started three virtual machines based on the Rancher OS AMI, and I configured them to join the cluster, right? And that's it. So that's pretty simple here. By the way, this is the ECS console, which is very basic, but you know, it's not supposed to be used for production. It's really more for testing than anything else. So here I don't have anything running. Okay, that cluster is empty. And I suppose, just make sure I want to configure it. All right, it's empty. Okay. And of course, if I look at this guy here, which is a really cool console, much better than ours, I can see, so that's the Rancher server. So it's running in a different instance, different EC2 instance. So I can see my three Rancher nodes, right? And I suppose I have no containers here either, right? Okay. Right, so really the only thing I did, once again, is start Rancher OS images and ask them to join the cluster called default, which is a configuration file in Rancher OS. And then, you know, you can get, I think, the best of both worlds. You can get the scalability of ECS and the scheduling of ECS, and you can get the cool management tools of Rancher. So let's start something here. So I'm going to show it. I mean, it's a silly PHP web app. It doesn't matter. I mean, it's really, the purpose here is just to show you the basics and the way things are uploaded, etc. So I've got a service called PHP demo. It's going to pull an image from ECR, right? So that's my registry is in the US. Why not? So I'm going to pull that image from there. The rest here, as you can see, is a strictly Docker compose file, right? And you can use volumes and environment variables and volumes from and multiple containers, blah blah blah. I mean, Docker compose is compatible with this, or this is compatible with Docker compose. The only difference here is that those two variables here are an indication that we give to ECS on how CPU heavy this task is going to be and how much memory it should get, right? So this is just a hint. It's a way, if you want to make sure a container runs kind of alone on an instance, you could give it all the points for an instance. T2 Micro, for example, has 1024 CPU points, right? And the more powerful the instance, the more CPU points it has. So if you wanted this container to run all alone on an instance, you would give it the maximum number of points, and it would run on its own. If it doesn't really matter, then you can have lower values. So it's a way it's a hint that you give to ECS to find out how CPU heavy this thing is going to be, and how much how much ECS instance power you want to give to that container. Okay, so basically here it's a couple of PHP pages on Apache. So I'm just going to do this, right? And of course I forgot this flag. And I forgot the key pair. That's not the right command actually. Sorry about that. The cluster is already up, so that's the one I was looking for. Got distracted here. Yeah. All right. So what happens here, as you can see, is so we're going to take that Docker Compose file. We're going to upload it to ECS. That becomes what we call a task definition, right? And so it's blue on black. I can't really see that, but there's a desired count, which is 1, right? And there's a running count, which is 0 here. And pretty soon running count is going to be 1 as well. And if I'm looking at my container here, right, I can see the task definition. So if I looked at this, I would see the equivalent of my compose file and see my container is in a pending state. And if I reload that page, I suppose it's going to be running soon. Come on. Of course, it's not going to be running. Yes, thank you. Okay. And so now I've got, if I go ECS CLIPS, right, I see my container running. So if I connect to this, which is the IP address of the ECS instance, hopefully I see my PHP page. Woohoo! Right, and if I go back to Rancher, well, I can see that this guy here is running a container. And then I can see lots of cool stuff about the container, right? So let's say I want more. So let's do this service scale 3. And so if I look at my service here, I can see, you know, desired task 3, running task 1. And then the scheduler is going to do his job and start some more instances in a second. I'm using very, very tiny instances. That's why I'm using T2 Micro. So that's why it's slower than it should be. If you use proper production instances, it's going to be really fast. Okay. All right. And so I can see my 3 tasks running. And if I look at that guy here, you know, they're joining too. And as you can see, you know, because this is running on port 80, and unfortunately there's only one port 80 per instance. I wish there were more, but in this case we're starting containers on fixed port. Here's the third one, right? The scheduler is actually trying to run. So this one was the first one, right? So he's going to look at instances and try to run the container. So let's say, you know, let's imagine it tried to run in here. You know, the port 80 is already bound, so the container is not going to start. So okay, that's not good. So it's going to look for another place to run it, right? Obviously, with 3 containers and 3 instances, again, it's a trivial example. Imagine this at scale, you know, thousands of containers on hundreds of nodes, and you're trying to find an instance where port 1234 is available, right? And that's where ECS is going to help you. Okay? So that's it. So if you like Rancher, and I have to say I like Rancher a lot. I like the Rancher server a lot. I think it's great. Can't believe how mature it is for such a young project. But so easy to integrate with ECS. So basically the setup that we saw here is kind of similar to that, right? We're running containers on fixed ports. Here we have 3 services, 1, 2, 3. As you can see, they're running on internally, they're all running on port 80, but on the instance, they're using different ports, right? Because again, on this instance here, there is only one port 80. So that means that we can't run two copies of service one on the same ECS instance. And that means if we need a fourth copy of service one, we would have to start a fourth container instance, right? Which, okay, that's, you know, might be a problem, might not be a problem, depends on your platform. You could use some load balancers to provide a single point of entry for your users to those services. But in any case, you don't have any service discovery here, right? So imagine someone else starts service four, like I did. There's no easy way for service one, two, and three to communicate with service four. The only way you would do that in this, with this architecture, you would have environment variables with the CNAMEs for the ELBs, and you would pass that to all the containers, right? So it's not very dynamic. Again, if you have a simple platform, if you don't have 100 services, that's fine, you can do that. But if you have a more dynamic platform, you need something else. So here's a different example where, so it's based on a blog post, pretty interesting, where we're using, we're registering services automatically when they, when they're created. And how we do that? We use a combination of CloudWatch and so our monitoring system that can send some events when a specific API is called. So in this case, when the create service API is called, CloudWatch is going to send an event to a Lambda function. So I know this is not a talk on serverless, but you probably have heard of Lambda functions. So it's a tiny piece of code that's going to run and register the service to Route 53 or our managed DNS service. And in this case, you know, things are slightly better because people can start new services on the cluster. And you know, an entry will get created automatically in Route 53 in the DNS zone with the service name, and then you know it becomes easier for the other services to do discovery. All they have to do, they have to do a DNS lookup on that service name, and they will get access to the ELB CNAME, ELB IP actually, and they can talk to other services, right? So more automated. But we still have that problem, right? Everything is still running on fixed ports, so only one container of a given type per ECS instance. So let's keep moving. Let's keep improving. So we could do fixed ports. We could do better service discovery using Weave. I guess you've heard about that. Again, it's another blog post. Pretty cool. And so here, so Weave is going to run on each instance, and it's going to do, it's going to detect that containers are starting. It's going to register the IP address of a given service to other nodes. It's a gossip protocol, so there is no central server like etcd or console or zookeeper or whatever, right? So no, you know, just collaboration between the nodes. And I will show you an example here. And here, it's from a code point of view, it's actually very simple because all you have to do is a DNS lookup in your code on the service name, and you will get the IP address of an instance that runs this service. Of course, you know, if you want to have internet-facing services, you can put an ELB in front of them, and you would still have that problem, you know, once again. But that's, at least you have a better architecture, a more dynamic architecture when it comes to creating services, destroying services, and allowing services to talk to one another. So let's look at an example of a very, very simple application on Weave. So that application is, where is it? Okay, so that's what I have here. So basically, I have that's my second cluster here. Sorry. So I've got three instances. Again, and I've got four tasks. So I've got a Redis task running. And I've got three web tasks that are just counting hits, right? So super fancy. Right? So when I'm doing this, actually it's a Python app that runs here. It connects, so it resolves, it discovers the Redis service. I'll show you the code in a minute, and increases a counter in Redis, right? And so you could do that on all three web servers, and obviously you would see the same value, the consistent value here in Redis. So let's look at Wiv. Oh my God. Okay, this is a little small probably. I'm sorry, I can't make it any bigger because it's not a proper shell. So what do I have here? So I have a Docker file here. So simple Python app. And let's look at the app. Okay, so apologies for the size, but this is what you were interested in, right? So it's a Flask app, and the first thing it does is get access to a Redis host, right? So basically just giving a host name here, which is the service name. That's what Wiv is actually doing, right? Well, when the Redis container started on one of the hosts, one of the instances, Wiv intercepted that information, informed all the other nodes. So all the nodes know that, all the Wiv agents know that the service called Redis is available at this IP address, right? And then, you know, basically what I do, I just increment a counter called hits in Redis. So I like this very much because, again, there is no infrastructure bullshit, right? From a programming point of view, you're looking for a host called Redis, and it could be anywhere on your cluster. You'll get access to that, right? So pretty clean way of programming things and doing simple stuff. And I like simple stuff because I'm a simple guy, right? And I think the Wiv console is actually pretty cool too, right? You could see the containers, and you can see, you know, you can click any, you know, you could click in all those places, right? I can see the internet connecting to my web servers, etc. So Wiv, right? So Rancher is pretty cool. Wiv is pretty cool. Just, you know, different ways of doing things. Different ways of doing discovery. Right? But, you know, we could still go crazier. Right? So if we want to go all the way, right? So if we want to go totally crazy, which I did here, we could do this. And so basically the problem I'm trying to solve with this is that I don't care. I want to be able to run as many containers of the same, coming from the same image on one node, right? I don't want to have that restriction that since I'm starting containers with fixed ports, I can only run one on each instance. You know, I don't want to do that. You know, why limit yourself? So here, I'm going to show you the application first. It's a web app built from three services. Here it is. So we have a portal service, which is the one that I'm accessing from the internet. And this service is building that page, right? And in the back end, I have two services, one called Stocks, which connects to the Yahoo Finance API to get stock quotes, and one called Weather that connects to the Open Weather API to find weather information, right? And so when I'm doing this, right, if I want to know the stock price of Amazon right now, right, I'm doing this. 7:15, okay, good. But what's more important is what happens when I click on this, right? So when I click on this, what I'm doing is I'm doing a service discovery to the stock service, right? And the stock service is actually calling the API and sending me the result, Okay, and I'll show you the code again in a minute. So anybody wants to see anything here? Should we look at Criteo? Okay, I can live with that. All right, let's look at Google. Come on. All right. Yep. All right. And same thing here, right? So it's 20 degrees. Can't really believe that, but okay. Yeah, much better. Well, kind of better. Yes. All right. That's one. Yeah, but they kill each other over there, so I don't want to go there. I need a quiet place somewhere. You know, what could that be? Yeah. I was there twice in 3 months, so I guess I got lucky. I feel very bad for them. So again, when I click on add here, I'm doing service discovery. Let me show you the code. All right. So is this the actually? No, that's not the useful part. All right, that's the good part. Okay, so I've got a lookup service function. Oh, it's we're missing the. Okay, no, that's okay. We can still see it. We have a lookup service function where I'm gonna give the service name, right? And what I'm going to do here, as you will see, I'll explain in a second, we're going to do, again, a DNS resolution. But this time, we're getting not only the IP address, we're also getting the port number of the service because we're relying on SRV records in DNS, which are designed to record services, so IP address and port numbers. And this is what I'm returning, right? So if I want to look up the stock service, I will just do lookup service stock price, and HTTP request to that port and IP address and get the result, right? Okay, and stock and weather are just get calling HTTP get from Yahoo and Open Weather Map. Okay, so again, from a programming point of view, pretty simple. If you understand what DNS is, and I guess everybody does, I hope, it's quite straightforward to put this in your applications, right? So now, while I explain it, let's do something stupid. So this is running on a third cluster, right? So as you can see. Oh, four instances, why? Okay. All right, four instances, why not? And I've got three copies of each service, right? So, just to prove my point, right, let's suppose I have a lot of traffic here, and I need a lot of containers to process that traffic. And this one too, yeah. All right. And so obviously the scheduler is a good boy. So immediately, as you can see here, it's gonna start some more containers, right? So see, I already have 11 here. And if I reload that page, it's going to run and run and run and run, right? So it's going to look for a decent place to put those stock and weather services. And obviously, pretty soon, I will run out of space, right? And that's the case here, right? The CPU points that I allocated to my task, they've been exhausted here on my four Docker instances, and that's a problem. So I will never be able, as you can see, I still have 42 containers to start. Oh my God, do you mean I need to wake up at night and do this? No, actually, that's a low number. Let's do more. Why not? I'm not paying for anything, so I can do stupid stuff like that. Okay, so we're gonna run out, right? So let me explain the architecture and then let's see if ECS figured it out or not, if it needs any help. So this is my architecture here. So the white blocks are the services, right? The ones I showed you. So the portal services and stock and weather, right? Running anywhere because they're all on random ports. So they could start anywhere. Between P and S and W, right? I show you the code. We do a local DNS lookup, right? Why is it local? Because I, on each instance, I have a console. I'm using console in this case to manage the distributed state. I have a console agent on each instance, and the portals are resolving locally, so it's really, really fast, and they get access to one of their little friends. So for example, let's say I'm hitting this portal, it's going to do resolution, maybe it's going to use this weather and this stock, right? And again, if I'm hitting this portal here, it might use this one and this one, who knows, you know, could be any of those. Because it, again, it's a distributed view. So how do we know, you know, so that's okay. I mean, the white stuff kind of makes sense. Now, what about the black stuff? So the black stuff, that's the ECS agent. That's the console agent with the console server here. And what's that R guy? So that R guy is a tool called Registrator. It's an open source tool that does only one thing. It detects containers starting and it sends events to console. So actually this guy is the one that knows, hey, we started a stock service on this instance with this IP address and this port number. And this is how you build the distributed state. It's because Registrator is spying on the Docker events, on the Docker startups, and sending that data to console, right? So R is kind of important. Now, what about the F stuff? Right. Well, that F guy is again is another open source tool called Fabio. It's an open source project as well, from eBay, I believe. And it's basically it's a zero configuration HTTP and HTTPS router. And why is it zero configuration? Because it can spy on the console traffic. So when this guy here starts, Registrator detects it, sends that notification to console, and Fabio detects it. And so how does Fabio know where all the P's are running? Because it's listening to the console traffic and it builds, that's how these guys build their routing tables. Okay? And this is how I can start all the P's on random ports. Okay? Because Registrator is listening and Fabio is listening to. And so all my fronts, right, are running on random ports, which means I cannot have an ELB in front of them, because one of the ELB limitations today is that an ELB can only balance entities running all on the same ports, right, which is clearly not the case here. So this is what Fabio is good for. Fabio actually here is the only guy running on fixed port, 9999, which is default for Fabio. So I have one Fabio on port 9999 on each instance, which is why I can have an ELB in front of it, right? And now if we look at the whole circle, you're going to come from here, the internet gateway, go through the ELB. The ELB is going to pick one of the Fabios round robin. Let's say that one, right? Fabio knows about all the P's because I explained it, right? Let's say it picks this one here. And P is going to do two DNS resolutions, one for S, one for W, pointing somewhere else, right? So when a container dies, Registrator will find about it, inform console, And if that's a, if a pea dies, well, then Fabio will see it and remove it again, right? And if one of the F dies, then the ELB sees it and removes it again, okay? So this is a more complex setup, obviously. It's kind of painful because I have an external entity here managing the state. Of course, this becomes a SPOF. You can you could have high availability on console. I mean, it's just read the docs and do it. But still, right? It's an external component. All those squares here are containers. So if I'm starting a fourth instance, then all that crap comes with it and joins the fun. Okay. So as far as I know, so this is based. I started from this demo and got fancy, right? So the Fabio stuff I added, et cetera, et cetera. So this is you know, as dynamic as you could get, right, on this architecture. Everything random, everything discovered automatically. A little bit complex, but this setup, actually, I put it together maybe 6 months ago, and I keep hitting it very hard, like, you know, creating thousands of containers and God knows how many instances, and it's still there. It never died. So, you know, maybe I'm just lucky, or maybe it's kind of stable. So let's look at my cluster here. So I've got four instances. And what? No auto-scaling? Oh, come on. How could that be? Oh, maybe I'm just impatient. Okay, so maybe I'm just impatient. So ECS. Anything starting here? Oops. Oh, I know why. Okay, I know why. So I will explain. So I've got an alarm here, right, that says if, you know, basically, if my cluster runs out of memory or runs out of CPU, which is clearly the case here, right? That's as close to 100% as it can, right? So this is going to send an alarm, right? That alarm here is actually, as you can see, it's an alarm, right? So the alarm is on. Probably I'm getting some emails right now. And where I'm sending the alarm is I'm sending it to an auto-scaling group, which is using spot instances, right? I'm not sure if you know about spot instances. So spot instances are instances that you can buy, that you can bid on, right? Aux enchères, okay? Given the time of the day, I expect that my bidding price is too low. When I'm doing this demo in the morning, it always works. But now, I guess, you know, Netflix is running at full speed. And, you know, I'm failing to grab some spot instances here. Oh, no, they are. Here they are. They're just initializing. Here they are. Okay. No. Okay. They're initializing here. So, all right. Saved. So let's look at ECS again. Yes, five instances. All right, that worked. Okay. And it's already full because I put a crazy, stupid number of containers. Okay, so this is how you can do automatic scaling on your containers, right? You will use the normal EC2 auto-scaling with your alarms, etc. So imagine my spot stuff miserably failed because actually Netflix is eating all of the internet and all of the AWS instances. What would I do? Would I be stuck? No, because I have another alarm that is much longer to trigger, right? This one triggers after maybe 2 minutes and the other one triggers after 15 minutes. So if after 15 minutes I'm still in deep shit, right? Because I couldn't grab some spot instances, then I will buy some on-demand instances, but they're more expensive, right? Spot is extremely cheap. This is why I'm trying to get those before I go to on-demand. Okay, so just to show you that you can reuse everything you know about EC2 and build some clever monitoring and scaling strategies to automatically scale up and down when you need to. Okay, so sauvé par le gong. Thank you, Spot instances. Thank you, Netflix, as well. All right, just to finish, there's another way to do things that has nothing to do with containers at all, right? I see a lot of presentations where, you know, the first bullet point says microservices and then the second says Docker. Okay, fair enough. Fair enough. I agree, it's a good match. But, you know, you don't have to use Docker containers to do microservices. There's this really super cool series of articles on the developer blog that shows you, it's not finished yet. I think it's in four parts and the fourth hasn't been published yet, but still, you can read those, where they show you how to build a microservice-based architecture using only the API gateway and Lambda functions and doing registration and discovery, storing everything in DynamoDB. It's a super technical article. All the code is in there, and you know, if you want to see, you know, if you're interested in serverless, it's a clever way of doing it, right? I'm not saying it's production ready or anything. I'm just saying it's a different way of looking at microservices, and you know, maybe a combination of Docker and serverless is interesting to look at. So if you want to know more. So we have a series of articles from the CTO of Amazon on ECS where, you know, he's giving you a little more insight on how things work and why ECS is able to scale in linear time. We have some videos from reInvent last year, which are still up to date and very interesting. If I remember correctly, this one is from Jérôme Petazzoni from Docker, who talked at our conference. So worth looking at. And the other ones are good too. And these are just for reference. If you want to look at Weave, oh, I forgot Rancher. How could I? If you want to look at Rancher, Weave, and Console, and Fabio, you know, you can get all the links. Final slide. We have user groups all across France. Obviously, there's one in Paris. I believe you guys are all from Paris, right? But you know, if you ever move to a different place in France, I wish you do that. You know, it's more fun to be in those different locations than Paris anyway. But, or if you have colleagues or friends in different locations, well, you can share with them the fact that we have user groups all across France now, with more coming. We have a group on Facebook as well, which is growing. And that's the official Twitter account for AWS. I'm done. Thanks a lot. You have my email and Twitter account. If you have any questions now or later, feel free to shoot me an email. If you guys are organizing other meetups and you would like to, some kind of talk on, you know, something that is related to AWS, and I'd be happy to talk about it. Just get in touch. Thanks again for inviting me. It was really cool. I hope you learned a lot of stuff. And thanks a lot.